It's even worse than that. Because what he's talking,
my math was okay.
What the Democrats and the Republicans, what the Democrats and Republicans are saying is they're going to cut spending $2 trillion over 10 years.
Yeah.
So that's only $200 billion in spending cuts right. in that proposal. Where our current deficits are about $1.5 trillion a year. So actually, it wouldn't be paying down the debt. You would actually only be growing your debt at a slower clip, according to these plans. That's what I don't think has really come to the forefront, is that we need to attack the debt. What we're talking about now in Washington are cuts of spending in out years. What happens every time we have spending cuts in the out years? The spending cuts never materialize. That's why the Obama administration has been pushing for tax increases in the short term with spending cuts in the long term, because their goal, and this gets to the heart of your first question, their goal specifically is to increase the revenues from tax increases today, push the spending cuts out into the future so they never materialize, and then you end up in a situation where in 2014 Obamacare gets implemented and 40 million new people come onto a government entitlement program that is going to require even higher taxes and more spending to be able to sustain it, and then we've reached the tipping point. And from there, I'm not sure you can ever come back. And that's why 2012 is so critical, because Obamacare is that beginning, if we've not already begun it, but Obamacare is that tipping point when you get to that situation where there is so much more government and so much more dependency that America starts to look even more like Eastern European countries that you left to come to pursue freedom and opportunity here in the United States. And so as I travel the state, the people that I find who are the most in tune with what's going on are people who left countries for the very same reason that we're now all standing up and fighting. And so whether it's been from Russia or Romania or from other places, Cuba, other places where people lost freedoms, you understand it. And you're saying the same thing I am, which is we can't allow this to happen on our watch. This is the time. This is the time to draw the line in the sand. This is about that fight that has taken place in other generations where they've risen to the challenge. Are we going to rise to that generation of challenge? Yes, sir.
Significantly small portion of the population is not going to have to get the reward system. They have banned any symbols of religion, God, Ten Commandments, or any religious letter. To point out, where they come the Bible, I guess. How is your stamp on the attack of God himself?
I think it has been actually one of the leading factors of our downfall and our decline as a country, because that is what we were based off of. That's what makes America unique and special. And as you continue to see that happen, as you continue to see God pushed out of the public square, as you continue to see people who are being ridiculed and criticized for their Christian beliefs or for their religious beliefs, that is what leads to a godless society, which becomes people being more dependent on a faceless government. And what concerns me the most is the climate of political correctness in this country. And that's what we need to be fighting against. That's what we need to stand up and be able to push back and join together. Because I really believe that it's been that deterioration and that breakdown that has led to the growth of government, that's led to the expansion of the size and scope of government. That's so critical to who we are as a country, and I think we need to speak forcefully. And the other part of that, as it relates to government, is that governors and presidents who are appointing judges, that's why this is, I was in the legislature, I watched Charlie Crist take a center-right court, make it a center-left court. That's why elections are so important. That's why we have to make sure as United States Senators that we're only approving judges who interpret the Constitution in a strict constructionist manner and not in a way that is going to be more in tune with the Ninth Circuit in San Francisco.
Yes, sir.
In previous events, you spoke more about the dangers of Sharia compliant Islam. What as a legislator, what kind of laws would you pursue to help us avoid that?
I think first and foremost, we need to make sure that we have American laws in American courts. And what we've seen now is the insinuation of an ideology and tenets and principles of something that's beyond just a religion that are in complete contradiction with the principles of the United States Constitution. And I think it is extremely important for us to protect the freedom of speech and protect the rights of individuals. We're seeing it now all over the state of Florida and in other places where Sharia Islam is not just a threat in the form of radical violence. I can give you all the instances and instances of these types of situations, whether it's been Fort Hood, whether it has been in Seattle, whether you've seen just now recently the two imams in Miami who were funneling money to Pakistan to train jihadists to kill Americans. We're seeing this now in our own society, and it's not just about violent jihad, but it's also about a civilizational jihad that is threatening our freedoms here in this country. And I think it's important to educate, and I think it's important to make sure that we do not risk giving up our tenets and principles of what we believe in our Constitution.
Just one follow-up. In the state legislature this year, there was a law that was introduced that would have banned foreign or religious law being used in courts. Would you consider doing something on a federal level?
There is legislation on a federal level already that I would support, correct?
A quick question. We heard President Obama yesterday say that the debt ceiling issue should be left to the professional politicians, which really irked me. It shows the progressive left doesn't believe in the American people. But what is the role of the American people in day-to-day issues of the government?
I think now more than ever, people are energized, educated, and are really, really engaged in what is going on in Washington, what's going on in state capitals, what's going on in town hall. And I think people need to hold their elected officials accountable so that they don't keep making the decisions that have allowed prior politicians to kick the can down the road. When I was in the state legislature, we had to pass a balanced budget every year. Wasn't always easy, wasn't always popular, but those were the decisions that we needed to make in order to meet our constitutional obligation. That's why I'm a big supporter of a balanced budget amendment in the federal constitution. But the reality is that it is our responsibility. It's why the Tea Party movement, it's why the 9/12 groups, it's why all of these groups have sprouted up, because they've realized that the professional governing class has gotten us into the situation that we have, and it hasn't just been Democrats, it's been Republicans too. And as we've continued to kick the can down the street, people now recognize that the America that they grew up in, the America that they want future generations to inherit, is now being threatened.
All right, guys, we're gonna, if we wanted to, it's getting pretty muggy and muggy out here. Yeah.
If you want to go inside.
Yeah, we could go inside.
And on immigration, realizing that Florida has a huge
No.
David.
Florida has a huge agricultural part to it.
Right.
But the Dream Act and amnesty and all of this is going to literally change the face of our country. And I really resent every time I have to press one for English.
Yeah.
And I don't know how we overcome this, because more and more people are not speaking the language of our country.
Yeah, I don't support the Dream Act, and I don't support any of the amnesty-like policies that are being proposed. I think what's important to remember is that our country is based and is comprised of a few important things. We're a nation of laws. But our nation is also dependent on being a nation of our culture, of our language, and our borders. And I think that's what makes us unique. Those are the things we need to protect. Those are the things we need to make sure don't deteriorate. And so,
But they have deteriorated.
They have, but that's why I think this is the time. This is the time to stand up. This is the time to I think reclaim the things that make our country unique and make our country special. And what we've seen, I think, over the last couple of years is this American awakening of people who may not have been paying attention for a long time, people who assumed that the elected representatives were making the decisions that were in the best interest of the future of this country. And that's why I think there's so much energy. That's why I think there's so many people who are so engaged right now. It's because maybe for the last 5 or 10 or 15 years, they weren't engaged, and they're making up for lost time. And they're saying, whoa, how do we get back what we thought we had? And for that decade or 20 years, whatever it is, that now, that's why this is such a pivotal moment in so many people's minds, because they recognize that over a long period of time, how far it's gotten away from them, like you said.